to the Wiley Pirates, Bill Howard. Now with Coach Howard, here's Scott Harrison.
Well, we are going to talk about a bi-district victory for the Wiley Pirates last Friday night in Royce City over the Mount Pleasant Tigers as the Pirates win it 45-21. Once again, welcome from Dickey's Barbecue. I'm Scott Harrison along with Bill Howard, the head coach of the Pirates. And Coach Howard has his hat pulled down tight because as a part of his agreement with the players, if they had gotten a victory in the bi-district round, he was going to dye his hair blonde. Are we willing to show it?
Yeah, I went blonde.
There we go. All right. Very nice. The players in the week leading up to the Mount Pleasant game had dyed their hair, at least parts of it, depending on the player, blonde. And as a show of solidarity, Coach Howard did so as well. And speaking of solid, the game on Friday night in Royce City against Mount Pleasant, you had talked all season long about trying to get these guys to a point where they were playing Wiley Pirate football. And I would say that except for maybe about 6 minutes in the second quarter, this was the most complete effort of the season for your guys.
Oh, without a doubt. You know, we came into the game, and I was a little nervous. Their offense is very good, and our defensive staff did a great job, and they set the tone. Again, we won the toss. We took the ball because I thought Cameron could really lead us down the field. I thought that might, you know, take an edge off our defense, let them settle in. We took it down. We scored. Then our defense there in the first quarter kind of took over. And you know, I take my hat off to my defensive coach and my defensive players. They went out and they played really well. And for the first time in a while, our offense, our defense, and our special teams all complemented each other. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that made for a fun night for us. We gave them an opportunity to get back in the game right there in the second quarter. And, you know, there were some things that I had up our sleeve that I just wasn't going to try to let that happen. We ran a fake punt. We missed the hole, missed the block, and gave them position down there. Mm-hmm. But we came back. Defense got a turnover. So they kind of made me look a little bit better than what I did. But all in all, besides that, the night went really well, and I was very proud of our effort.
Alex Pena-Roden came out of that game with two interceptions going both ways, playing offense and defense. He had a tremendous game. A number of guys over there. But on special teams, the little short pooch kick over that front line netted you, I believe it was three fumbles, maybe four fumbles, that you were able to get. Set up short fields, demoralized the Tigers, I thought, and took the ball out of the hands of Montravius James, their quarterback, and Ladarius Cannon, their incredibly talented wide receiver.
Well, our kicker has a lot more confidence. Mm-hmm. And, you know, he drilled that field goal. Matter of fact, he drilled both field goals. Mm-hmm. Right through there. And, you know, if you can put the ball where they're not, mm-hmm. It helps a whole lot, especially when they're very talented at running it back. You know, I'm really proud of all our special teams because our kids just tussle. There was one kickoff where we had a chance to return it, and everybody's locked up, but the ball was kicked perfect, and we got back out to about the 40 still. But you know, our kids are playing with great effort. And, you know, that just offense, defense, special teams, when your kids play with great effort, you know, as a coach, you can't ask for any more than that. Now you just got to be smart and execute, and we did that Friday night. It was a fun night.
This Mount Pleasant team was averaging 506 yards of offense per game. They were held to, let's see here, it was the total 104 on the ground and 137 through the air, so what is that, 241? Mm-hmm. They were scoring 48.8 points per game. You hold them to 21, 7 points only in the second half. And offensively, you guys got a burst thanks to some of their mistakes and efforts and not liking to kick the ball, especially early on. You got 11 of 11 until Cameron Kelly went out with an injury, and then Carson Cook came in. He had really struggled, I thought. Only 1 of 4 in the game against Royce City, and I think maybe 48% passing and kind of up and down against Sherman. What was it about that 1-2 punch on Friday night that made the offense go?
Well, you know, the Sherman game, he didn't start, and as we rotated him in, we didn't have a very good night on either quarterbacks that night. The Royce City game, it was we were out of sorts too. But you could kind of feel it. We had a very good week of preparation. Our coach selected as a great job of preparing our quarterbacks, getting them ready. And You know, Carson has a lot of confidence. He plays a lot of confidence. He's not new to it. They were giving us certain things, and Carson took advantage of it. He made some really good throws. He made a couple key runs. So we'll go ahead, and, you know, it's nice to have that option to have either one of those quarterbacks in.
Carson goes 20 for 27 for 198 yards, three touchdowns, no interceptions. I mentioned Cameron's numbers, 11 of 11. I think it was 101 yards maybe. Also had a two-point conversion throw, but no touchdowns. He got a touchdown from Opoku, his first of the year. You, on that play, I noticed the splits on the offensive line might have been two, almost 3 yards wide. What were you seeing up front that you were trying to establish there?
Well, we've been doing that off and on all year long. It's just our Raider offense.
So that's just a call that you guys send in on the signal.
We just stay and we see if the defense is going to adjust, and when they do, we can make call one way off of it. So, I mean, you know, Royce has gone up in the press box the last half of the season. And, you know, I think he's, you know, personally, I think Royce is one of the best coaches on the field as far as seeing things, but he even does a better job seeing it in the press box, and he has been able to exploit certain things on other people's defense that we need to exploit. So, you know, it's nice to have somebody up there you trust that can make the right call.
Let's talk injury-wise. I know you can't give all details, but Cameron Kelly did come out of the game at one point after being pulled down from behind. What is his status going to be as you head into Friday?
It's day to day, and it'll be a question mark, you know, for Friday. I'm not for sure exactly what our role with him is. Carson's taking most snaps this week, but besides that, we're healthy and we're just going to go forward.
All right, it is Friday night in Tyler. 6 o'clock is the kickoff time on the day after Thanksgiving. There was some question earlier this week about where it will be played. We'll touch on that and also take a look at the John Tyler Lions as we continue on the Bill Howard Show from Dickey's right after this.
Dickies, we don't try to be all things to all people. We know how to do one thing well. Hot pit smoke, great barbecue. We buy only the highest quality meats for barbecuing. We season them and smoke them slow over hickory wood. Dickies, smoked here, loved everywhere.
Okay, we're back on the Bill Howard Show, and we are live from Dickey's Barbecue. And, of course, you can join us here on Friday night with our pregame starting at 5:30, WileyPirateFootball.mobi, as we will be coming to you from East Texas. Tyler, I guess it's Trinity Mother Francis Rose Stadium still.
Yeah,
they
correct.
Still have the extensive sponsorship deal with the hospital out there. I guess the last time that I was there was maybe in the East Texas Classic year two when you went out to play the Colony back, I guess, before you took over as head coach under Mark Ball. Have you been back since? I know that there was the playoff game a few years ago against John Tyler at Wiley Stadium that turned out in a good way for the Pirates.
Nope, we haven't been back since then, but the 2 years we went out there, we had good memories. We won both games. It's a nice complex, nice dressing facility, so, you know, it's a nice venue for our kids to play. It'll be loud and rocking. It'll be a playoff atmosphere, and we're really looking forward to it.
Originally, we were thinking it was 6 o'clock at Hamby Stadium on Friday night. What happened there that caused that to have to be switched? Was it a UIL requirement?
It's a UIL rule, even though that's really not what I agreed to. It's not what we agreed to. They have a new athletic director since then. They have a new head coach. And the UIL states that the only contract, because we got a clarification on this, is where did we play? We played at Wiley. So in the next 2 years, if we play a playoff game, we have to return it there. So once the UIL said that, I told him I'd play him on the concrete if we had to, and we're going. So that's
all
just
right.
That's the way it is. I don't really care where we play. It would have been nice to play a little closer to home for our fans, but as far as the stadium, Tyler's a much nicer stadium, so it'll be a great place to play.
John Tyler, a team that comes into this game at 10-1. They were 9-1 during the regular season, 4-1 in their district. A 77-20 victory over Waxahachie in the bi-district round. What have you seen from the game film of that? What other film have you looked at, and what are you expecting? Certainly, it seems that from an offensive standpoint, Greg Ward, their quarterback, and Fred Ross, their wide receiver, are similar to Mount Pleasant, kind of the 1-2 punch.
Yeah, and they're very explosive. Their only loss this year was Lancaster, so they were district champions. So as far as they're coming in on high, the Waxahachie game last week, Waxahachie just was not a good matchup for them. Waxahachie is a very run-oriented team. Mm-hmm. They got behind. They couldn't throw the ball very well. And then they had a huge fight in the game. And there were some suspensions and everything, but everybody from John Tyler will be back this week. So when you go in there and you show your kids the number two team in the state, you show them how explosive they are. But, you know, it's not much different than Mount Pleasant. They're probably maybe a little better on the defense side. We've got to play a little better on the defense. Don't get me wrong. They're number two in the state for a reason. They were number two in the state the last time they came here.
Yep.
And they're a very talented team. But the whole deal is the concept that we have to do is we have to take care of what we can do. We got to move the ball. We got to take care of the ball. Defense has got to get some stops. And we just have to be really sound in the kicking game. And right now we've had good practices. Our kids emotionally are ready.
Mm-hmm.
Physically, we'll be ready by Friday. You know, you get the nicks and bruises from the last game over with. We still got a few little nagging. But, you know, the mental part of the game is so important. You know, our kids are going to play with great confidence, and hopefully we'll be able to come out with a win.
I want to talk about that confidence because this is a team that we talked in those darkest days of the 0-2 start in district and the overtime losses to begin the year about how those guys would keep their mentality where it needed to be so that they would have this opportunity that they're having right now, getting to the postseason. Where does that come from? Is that an Amo thing? I'm a kid that grew up in Wiley watching great teams come before me. Is that the leadership of your captains? Where is all that coming from?
Well, you know what? I think it might be just a little bit of all of those things. But, you know, each team, any team that's any good has to have an edge. You know, Coach Whitman, it was all those years, we always tried to have an edge. And it was very important that we did have an edge. And our edge was we were going to be stronger and more physical than teams, or we were going to out-hustle them, or we were just going to play 48 minutes, and the team that plays the hardest, longest is going to win. But bottom line is, this team just never quits.
Mm-hmm.
And that's been – if a team never quits, even though there's been some games we've been taken out of, we've always fought back to get in. We've been in every game this year except for one, and we just didn't have the offensive firepower to do that game because we didn't have a quarterback. So as far as this team's edge is we're going to fight, and you're going to fight us for 48 minutes. And, you know, if you know that that's going to happen, and our kids do know, that gives you great confidence. And I'm really excited about the way our kids compete, the way they hustle. And, you know, as a coach, it makes you really proud that your team's going to go out there and lay it on the line. Win, lose, or draw. You know, the first five games didn't go the way we want, but now we won five out of six. We beat a very good team out of East Texas. Now we got another very good team out of East Texas.
Defensively, Tyus Bowser is 6'3", 230, and a really athletic defender for the Lions. You've seen big, strong, fast defenders. We saw some at West Mesquite. Seen big, fast, strong guys on the offense at Wiley East. How do those guys on the offensive side, when they're lining up on that offensive line, look up and see the Tyus Bowser, and what's their thought process at that point?
Well, we saw him 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. He was a sophomore, and he's very good. And what we just have to do is we'll come up with a game plan that kind of negates part of him. He's going to make his plays. He's a big-time recruit. But we'll do certain things that get him out of his comfort zone. And, we'll put additional blocker on if we have to. As far as their skill kids, number nine last week from Mount Pleasant, he was going to Texas. These guys are going to OSU, different things. I mean, we play against some of the best players in and out of the state week in, week out. That's what Texas high school football is about. That's what makes it so great.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody wants to – that's why you fill up stands. They're very talented on offense, but – you know, the big thing that we have to do Friday night is we just have to tackle. They get a lot of yards after catch,
okay.
You know, and their yak yards are probably – they probably had 300 yak yards last week. So if we get there and we make the play and make them work their way down the field, then we have an advantage. You know, this Friday night we'll have a college-type crew, officials. We'll have seven officials out there, which I really wanted, and won the toss on that pretty much. So
okay.
That's going to be a good thing for us. And, you know, we might be able to expose certain areas, and they're going to try to expose certain areas. So basically it's going to come down to if we can keep their stars in check, and we can do what we have to do with the stars that we have.
When I got here to set up for our show, Bill Fowler, he and his wife Kathy, of course, owned Dickey's Barbecue. He came over and said, "Well, we're playing another week. What do you know about John Tyler?" And I said, "Well, I think we know that East Texas districts may not scare us as much as we thought they would going into the bi-district round. Looking at the district that they come out of, 16-4A, Corsicana, I believe we're 6-4 coming out of that district. Jacksonville made the playoffs at 4-6, much as you guys did. Lindell and Nacogdoches, not really up years from them. They play Tyler Lee every year, of course, but I think Lee this year had one win. Are you able to look at anything in their schedule here in district and non-district and get some idea of, because I'm thinking from the fan standpoint, what do they look at to try to get an accurate feel for what the possibilities are on Friday night for the Pirates?
Well, I tell you what, John Tyler is very good, and they're well coached, and they do a good job of being athletic. I mean, they're very athletic. And from a standpoint, we will not play anybody tougher than John Tyler this year. So our kids know that.
Mm-hmm.
So on the other hand, you know, this is a big ball game, because if we can get by John Tyler, now the wheels really start rolling. You know, but it's going to take a very good effort for us to get by John Tyler, and it'll take a very team effort to win this ball game. But after our kids have seen the film and have gone through practice, our confidence level is pretty in a really good spot right now.
Ricklin Holmes, the head coach of the Lions, is an alumni of John Tyler, played on some of their championship teams, and he'll be the guy that faces off next to this guy on Friday night, Bill Howard, as he takes the Pirates into Tyler to take on the John Tyler Lions in the area round of this 4A Region 2 Division 1 bracket. We will have our pregame show at 5:30 live from Tyler, so be sure and join us for that, and of course all the action here at WileyPirateFootball.mobi. Bill, thanks so much. Congratulations, and look forward to seeing you out in East Texas on Friday night.
All right. I'd like to see a big crowd out there.
Have a good Thanksgiving, everybody. For Bill Howard, I'm Scott Harrison. That's the Bill Howard Show from Dickey's. We'll see you next time.